I want to welcome everybody. My name is Ron Weisberger. I'm the director of the Bristol Community College Holocaust Center, and we're presenting this program together with our history department. We've been working on this for a long time, and it's always exciting to see it come to fruition. This is a very important subject, as you all know, you're here. We need to learn more about it, and we will learn more about it. I've learned some, and I'm looking forward to learning more from our keynote speaker, Dr. Jacoby, is from a distinguished historian from Columbia University, and we have a distinguished panel, local leaders, which will be introduced. So this is very important. The Holocaust Center started a couple years ago. We were locating cases. We have a resource center on the second floor of our library, and you're all welcome to show and borrow books and DVDs on the both the Jewish Holocaust, but other genocides. And our job really is to shed some light and provide education on, sadly, the amount of genocides that have occurred and are occurring even as we speak. What we hope is, at least through education, we can begin to make people more aware and then perhaps avoid future genocide, which has really been the scourge of our society, as we know. And today we're going to be talking about a genocide that sometimes people don't think about, but has extended over a long period of time in our country's history. And as I say, you'll be getting a lot more information about that very quickly. We do, our Holocaust Center does outreach. We're working also with the schools. The K through 12 schools are basically from middle school and high school too. So that's important to get students early as well as deal with our college and then the general public. We are funded by, the college supports us. We are funded by the Jewish Federation of New Bedford. Got funding from the Jewish Appeal of Fall River, and also individual contributions. And we, as you saw, we have a raffle or a drawing out there with really wonderful prizes, and we've had great sponsors, which names you can see in the back here. So take advantage of that. Hopefully you'll be a winner, and there's some really wonderful things, but that's part of our attempt to raise funds. The more money we have, obviously, the more we can do. Many people are responsible for bringing this about. I won't go into all the names. You can see our committee, which is on in our program, on, we don't have numbered pages, but anyway, our conference planning committee, Michael Simpson, who has been wonderful bringing together a lot of the local leaders, Robin Worthington, who is in our history department, Linnell Dean, who's my assistant, who helps to organize a lot of what we do, the logistics. So we're all, we were the committee. We have a number of sponsors, you can see, who I just mentioned a couple who help us. And we have a wonderful volunteer staff, which also are very important, most of our students. And again, their names are on here. And again, on the back, these are the donations from our various sponsors. And hopefully you'll take something home from one of them. All right, so again, thank you for coming. Some of the people who I always call in the cheap seats, if you want to come back closer, you can do that. Otherwise, you know, I think we have good speakers here. But anyway, what I want to do before we begin is first of all introduce our president, Jack Sprague, who, as always, supports all of our programming, and he wants to welcome you for the college, right?
Well, thank you, Ron, and welcome, everyone. This is quite an event for the college to be hosting, and I do want to give Ron a great deal of credit for helping start our Holocaust Center here at the college. It's a very important part of the fabric of the college, and he has done wonderful work in establishing it with very little budget, unfortunately, and made it go a long way, what little that he is able to get for these programs. I'm so happy about today. You know, when you think of the Holocaust Center, our thoughts immediately turn to World War II, but there is a broader context in American history, and that we're going to be looking at some of it today with the Native American story. I say chapter, but chapter kind of connotes that there's an ending, a beginning and an end of the chapter, and this is a continuing story, unfortunately, in the United States today. There are trials and tribulations of Native Americans persist, despite well intentions to the contrary. So I'm very grateful to Dr. Jacoby for coming and providing our keynote address. I want to remind you that next week, next Thursday, we have Dr. Lawrence Langer coming from Simmons University also to speak on the World War II Holocaust survivor testimonies. So there's been a good series of events throughout the year. The spring is winding down our semester, but Ron and the many people who are working in the Holocaust Center and the production of it are planning a vibrant program for next year as well. So this is a very important topic. I think that it's sometimes overlooked and it's not always covered in the history classes the way it should be, the attention that it merits. So I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you can spread the word after you hear the things that you hear. It's going to be entertaining somewhat as well. We have presentations and performances, panel discussion that will be very enlightening for all of us. So I'm going to return it to our Holocaust director, Dr. Ron Weisberger. And again, thank you very much for coming.
I know Dr. Sprague is a historian himself, so I know he really appreciates work that deals with history and all its facets. Very quickly, before I introduce Robin Worthington to introduce our I wanted to mention two things. One is that on April 23rd is the Holocaust Remembrance, which is called Yom HaShoah in a Jewish calendar. And the Jewish Federation and Congregation Teref Israel sponsors a program at 6:30. This is the 23rd. There's a memorial service at Buttonwood Park, there's the area. And then we have a program beginning at 7 with Rabbi Joseph Pollack, who's a child survivor of the Holocaust. And hearing survivors is always amazing. We had one last Thursday. Those of you who can make it, please keep that in mind. That is, again, April 23rd in New Bedford. There's also Professor Catherine Adamowitz is offering a Native American literature course in the fall. And it's at 4 o'clock on a Thursday. So teachers can hopefully can make it, and other people, because this is something the college does offer, Native American literature, which is very important. And so any of you are interested, I think Professor Adamowitz is here somewhere back there. You may want to talk to her about that. But that's, again, program. And also, we have a number, as Dr. Sprague mentioned, we do have a program this Thursday with Lawrence Langer, who's one of the pioneers in Holocaust literature and memoirs. And memoirs are really important. These are people who went through the Holocaust and left a message for us. And Dr. Langer is a pioneer in talking about these memoirs and what it teaches us. So this Thursday at 4 o'clock here will be in H210. So that's our next program. All right? So I'd like to introduce Professor Robin Worthington, who's been a key member of our planning committee, and she's going to introduce our keynote speaker, Robin.
Well, good morning, everyone. Last summer, as Dr. Weisberger and I were starting to plan for this conference, on a lark, I sent an email to a well-known scholar at Columbia University to ask him if he'd be willing to serve as our keynote speaker. To my surprise and delight, he quickly replied in the affirmative, and so this morning, it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Karl Jacoby. Dr. Jacoby received his AB in 1987 from Brown University and his PhD in American history in 1997 from Yale University. After a year as a visiting assistant professor at Oberlin College, he returned to Brown as an assistant professor of history in 1999. In the fall of 2012, he moved to Columbia University, where he currently serves as a professor in the Department of History and in the Center for the Study of Ethnicity and Race. I was introduced to Dr. Jacoby's scholarship in graduate school through his book, Shadows at Dawn, a complex and nuanced presentation of the events surrounding Arizona's Camp Grant massacre. Uniquely told from the perspectives of four different cultures, this book received numerous awards, including the Albert J. Beveridge Award in American History from the American Historical Association. He is the author of two other books, Crimes Against Nature, Poachers, Squatters, Thieves, and the Hidden History of American Conservation, and his most recent, The Strange Career of William Ellis, the Texas slave who became a Mexican millionaire. Additionally, Dr. Jacoby has written numerous book reviews, book chapters, essays, peer-reviewed articles, including his most recent Golden State Genocide State, which appeared in the Journal of Genocide Research in January of this year. I would continue, but you didn't come here to listen to me. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Karl Jacoby.
Good morning, everyone. So before I begin, I just wanted to thank Robin and Mike Simpson, all the other organizers from Bristol Community College and elsewhere who made today possible. Over the years, I've participated in a fair number of panels on indigenous genocide in the Americas at various universities. And usually these just feature academics talking to other academics. And so it's especially important and meaningful that in this conference today, in contrast, it features many prominent representatives from local Native communities. And I just wanted to say how honored I am to share the stage with them and to share in this conference with them. It's a daunting responsibility to try to convey the magnitude of the violence out of which the world we inhabit today was constructed. The extreme dispossession of Native communities that took place in the US is something that on some level should be obvious to us all. For millennia, after all, this entire continent of North America, including the very land that I'm standing on at this moment, was Native land. This means that if we want to speak accurately about American history, the overwhelming majority of this history, of course, would be Native history, with the arrival of non-Natives being a very late, very sudden, and very disruptive development in the far, far longer history of the human presence on this continent. When Europeans did first show up, their presence was at first confined to just a few small footholds in Plymouth, Jamestown, Santa Fe, and the like. Demographically, even after these first invasions, the overwhelming majority of the inhabitants of North America were Native peoples. Today, of course, the situation is reversed. Most land in North America is in non-Native hands. Non-Natives are the demographic majority in the US, and the descendants of the continent's indigenous communities are only about 2% of the United States population. Instinctually, most of us realize that there must be a story of massive violence behind this extraordinary transformation of the continent, even if we're unaware of the particulars. And I hold myself up as a leading example of this tendency. I grew up in Massachusetts and Rhode Island. I attended what were considered to be excellent schools in both states, yet I never heard of King Philip's War, the cataclysm that would devastate Native communities in Rhode Island, Massachusetts, and much of the rest of New England, until in any of my classes, K through 12, college included. Not until I went to graduate school did I even hear the words King Philip's War uttered and begin to grasp the horrifying chain of events that had made my comfortable upbringing possible. Indeed, this realization helped me recognize one of the first duties of the historian, that we have to be willing to stare into the abyss and face what most among us would prefer not to see and not to think about. If we stare into the abyss long enough, we can begin to pick out of the detritus cast here and there by the violent storms of the past. I wanted to start by sharing a few of these scraps with you, for they can convey some of the terror that Native people experienced in the face of a massive wave of violence. If I were a colonial historian, I might have examples from King Philip's War for you. Instead, I'm a historian who specializes in what are quaintly called the Indian Wars of the mid-19th century, which were, in fact, bloody wars of empire and conquest. So my examples come from that time period. And together, these scraps can give us a sense of what the famous story of the winning of the West looked like from the Native experience. The first example comes from Arizona. During a treaty parley between the U.S. Army and Apache Indian band, the Apaches reported that a neighboring Native community, the Zunis, had told them that after the Navajos surrendered, and here the Apaches are referring to the Navajo Long Walk, when they were forced out of their homeland and brought to Bosque Redondo, and many of them starved to death during this process. After the Navajo surrendered, the U.S. Army killed all the men and left none alive but women and children, of whom we made slaves. At much the same time, far to the north, in what was then Washington Territory, a rumor began to circulate among Washington's tribes that the U.S.'s recent effort at treaty making had been a cruel exercise in deception. Rather than securing reservations for the territory's native peoples, the treaties instead seemed to promise a horrifying bargain. Indian communities told one another that, quote, if they sold their land, they also sold themselves for slaves, that Governor Stevens, and he's the politician who negotiated the treaties, had sent for five large ships to transport all the Indians to an island in the ocean where the sun never shined. Our next account comes from Sarah Winnemucca, a northern Paiute from the area around Nevada. And she writes, the following spring, there was a great excitement among my people on account of fearful news coming from different tribes that the people whom they called their white brothers were killing everybody that came in their way, and all the Indian tribes had gone to the mountains to save their lives. There was a fearful story they told us children. Our mothers told us that the whites were killing everybody and eating them. We were all so afraid of them. Every dust that we would see blowing in the valleys, we would say it was the white people. Oh, what a fright we all got one morning to hear that some white people were coming. Everyone ran as best they could. My poor mother was left with my little sister and me. Oh, I can never forget it. My poor mother was carrying my little sister on her back and trying to make me run. But I was so frightened, I could not move my feet. And while my poor mother was trying to get me along, my aunt overtook us, and she said to my mother, let us bury our girls, or we shall all be killed and eaten up. So they went to work and buried us, and told us if we heard any noise, not to cry out, for if we did, they would surely kill us and eat us. So our mothers buried me and my cousin, planted sage bushes over our faces to keep the sun from burning them, and we were left there all day. Oh, can anyone imagine my feelings buried alive, thinking every minute that I was to be unburied and eaten up. With my heart throbbing and not daring to breathe, we lay there all day. It seemed that night would never come. Our final account also comes from Arizona, following an attack by a band of vigilantes from Tucson, Arizona, on a sleeping camp of Western Apaches in Aravaipa Canyon. a well-watered oasis in an otherwise arid environment. The attackers killed some 140 Apaches, most of them sleeping women and children, and took 20 or so children captives who were forcibly adopted into local families. Only hours later, a U.S. Army officer from a nearby base visited the massacre site and recorded the following account of the atrocity and its aftermath. "Many of the men," wrote the officer, "whose families had all been killed, were obliged to turn away, unable to speak. The women, whose children had been killed or stolen, were convulsed with grief. Children, who had 2 days before been full of fun and frolic, kept at a distance, expressing wondering horror." These shards of evidence convey the wide range of fears percolating through Native communities as they told one another about what the United States had done to them. Their fears of death, fears of enslavement, fears of a hideous island where the sun never shines, fears of being eaten alive, of being buried alive and left to die far from one's loved ones. Such Native stories of terror highlight one of the fundamental paradoxes in attempting to write a history of genocide. For violence both creates and destroys history. It creates history in the sense that it produces an intense desire among both perpetrators and victims to explain what they have done or what has happened to them, to bear witness to these transformative events in their full horror. Yet violence also destroys history in the sense that those physically annihilated in violent encounters cannot recount what happened to them. So we are left to contemplate a permanent, gaping absence in the historical record. As a Holocaust survivor, Primo Levi, once observed, "The destruction brought to an end, the job completed, was not told by anyone. No one ever returned to describe his own death." Moreover, as the last account with its description of Apaches being unable to speak reminds us, even if one survives settler violence, one might struggle to articulate the traumatic events that they'd experienced. The wondering horror that suffuses this last account persists even today as a challenge for the discipline of history. Given the narrative character of the historical enterprise, we historians inevitably assume an awesome responsibility of doing what the dead cannot do, and what even many survivors of violence could not do, to set horrific events into a narrative frame, and in so doing, to attempt to distill meaning out of chaos, to describe the indescribable and explain the inexplicable. In my comments today, I want to touch on what I see as a deep and as yet unresolved tension in the historical enterprise. There's on one hand a profound need for honest reckoning with the hyperviolence of settler colonialism in North America, to identify instances of genocide in the American past and to call them by their rightful name. On the other hand, the recent efflorescence of work on genocide against American Indians, and it is, this bears noting, a very recent efflorescence and much more work needs to be done on this. It risks disrupting other vitally important recent developments in the historical profession, especially those efforts to reclaim Native agency, subjectivities, and epistemologies that have been grouped under the label the New Indian History. It ought to mortify and embarrass all of those like myself who call ourselves American historians that for most of its existence, our discipline has not just ignored genocide against Native peoples, but actively served to justify it. Several of the participants in the massacre of the sleeping Apache in Arapahoe Canyon, for example, went on to found the Arizona Historical Society. Not surprisingly, the histories this settler-dominated society produced celebrated the massacre in which they participated as bringing peace and prosperity to Arizona and thereby demonstrating the tight linkage that has long existed between the physical violence enacted by settlers against Natives and the representational violence against Natives enacted in historical texts. The observation the Pequot writer William Appice made in the early 1800s still contains a great deal of truth. "American Indians," he wrote, "have been doubly wronged by the white man. First, driven from their native soil by the sword of the invader, then darkly slandered by the pen of the historian." There is thus a real value for historians in reclaiming our role as truth tellers and in demonstrating the existence of genocide in the American past, an existence that many whites continue to deny even today. To give just one recent example, many of you may recall, in late 2015, a controversy erupted at California State University at Sacramento when a Navajo Maidu student named Chitanabi Johnson protested that her white history teacher, Maury Weissman, denied the existence of genocide against Native Americans in the university's history classes. It's, to me, painfully ironic that this took place in California, one of the locations in the United States that presents the clearest case of Indian genocide during the national period. And for those of you who want to read more about this, I'd suggest my friend Ben Madley's recent book, An American Genocide, which talks about genocide against Native peoples during the Gold Rush. During the Gold Rush, California's Native population declined by 80% from an estimated 150,000 people to some 30,000 people. It wasn't primarily disease, and I'll have more to say about disease in a few minutes, but rather attacks by settler militias and U.S. Army units alike, such as the one at the appropriately named Bloody Island, when in 1850 U.S. soldiers killed as many as 800 men, women, and children of the Pomo tribe. Such acts were sanctioned by the governor of California at the time, Peter Burnett, who funded militia attacks on Indians, who stated in his 1852 address to the California legislature that a war of extermination will be continued to be waged between the two races until the Indian race becomes extinct, must be expected. While we cannot anticipate this result with but painful regret, the inevitable destiny of the race is beyond the power and wisdom of man to avert. It's because of controversies like the one at Cal State Sacramento that the historians who have pioneered the history of genocide have almost uniformly used the definition found in the UN's 1948 Convention on Genocide, which was finally ratified by the US in 1988 as their reference point. The definition is acts committed with intent to destroy, in whole or in part, a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group. Just read that one more time so you can hear the official UN definition. Acts committed with intent to destroy, in whole or in part, a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group. It's not that the UN's definition is necessarily the most precise or illuminating definition of genocide for reasons that I'll discuss in a moment, but it is the definition with the most status in international law, so that if one wants to link American history to the history of genocide, it's the logical starting place. And making this connection clear in turn will enable us to have a necessary and long overdue conversation about what the US can and should do to address the legacies of its genocides towards Native Americans. Nevertheless, relying on the UN definition of genocide poses several challenging problems for the historical enterprise. The first can be found in the phrase acts committed with intent to destroy. Now, from a legal definition, talking about intent makes a lot of sense. That intent is what separates something like a premeditated first-degree murder from some sort of accidental negligent manslaughter. The problem for historians, however, is that in trying to adapt a legal definition to historical analysis, the documents that rely upon principally describe external behavior, what someone did, when, with whom. They're often less illuminating as to an interior state of mind, like intent. The all too frequent absence of conclusive evidence of intent has allowed those who wish to do so to claim that as violent as US actions towards American Indians may have been in practice, these acts were not necessarily committed with a clear stated intent to destroy Native communities. The violence that one does see is instead an accidental consequence of settler colonial policies. According to this logic, it may be tragic, but it does not rise to the level of genocide. To return momentarily to the recent controversy in California. This lack of intent is what Professor Weissman at Sacramento State used to explain why he didn't think genocide had taken place in the United States. Another more scholarly example might be the peculiar argument in Gary Anderson's recent 2014 history, Ethnic Cleansing in the Indian. And this makes a curious argument that even though Native Americans experience ethnic cleansing, and this is something that he thinks can be objectively measured by analyzing the spatial geography of North America, there's no evidence that they experienced genocide, again, because he could see no evidence of intent. Those who adopt this position often support their argument by pointing out that in those documents that do address intent, such as the letters and journals of US soldiers involved in the 19th century's Indian Wars, many aver any desire to kill non-combatants, such as the elderly, women, or children. Soldiers claim that such occasions were unplanned and only took place because Native men did not observe proper military decorum and hid among their family members, or that Native women, by threatening soldiers, did not observe proper gender roles. Thus, John Comfort, an enlisted man in the 1st Artillery Division and a participant in the 1890 Wounded Knee Massacre, defended his unit's use of Hotchkiss cannons on the Lakota combatants and non-combatants alike by asserting, quote, "It was a terrible thing to do, but the warriors were mixed with the squaws and were firing rapidly with their Winchesters, and squaws were seen to kill wounded soldiers. The killing of squaws and children was unavoidable and a mixed melee of a fight." In other words, the death of women and children was an unplanned, unintended outcome of decisions that the Indians themselves had made. So if anyone was to blame, it was in fact the Indians. And according to this logic, the fact that the US Army had placed rapid fire Hotchkiss cannons all around a camp filled with women and children had nothing to do with the disproportionate loss of Native life. The late, much mourned scholar Patrick Wolfe labeled this misreading of violence against Native peoples as an intentional fallacy, and noticed that it was premised on a liberal individualist style of utopianism that privileges expressions of intention, no matter how contradictory to historical experience, over collective outcomes, no matter how emphatic their historical regularity. In other words, Wolfe is arguing one needs to look at what US policies actually did to Native peoples, and here there's clear evidence of the destruction of Native communities, and not be misled by the seemingly benevolent rhetoric that policymakers use to justify their actions, which often framed Army actions in terms of protecting Indians from settler violence by putting them on reservations. If the Army did kill Indians, it was because Natives didn't follow its advice and moved to their assigned reservations. To revise Wolfe's famous definition of settler colonialism, Patrick Wolfe defines settler colonialism as a structure, not an event. We might say that genocide of Native peoples is a structure, not an intent. The question of intent has also allowed some historical discussions of genocide to become overly consumed with the subject of introduced diseases. The argument is relatively simple, since diseases such as smallpox, measles, chickenpox, malaria, yellow fever, etc., were outside the control, or indeed in many cases even the comprehension of the non-natives who brought them to the Americas after 1492, their spread and the tremendous loss of life they caused was unconscious and unintended. As Jared Diamond put it in his Pulitzer Prize-winning book, Guns, Germs, and Steel, far more Native Americans died in bed from Eurasian germs than on the battlefield from European guns and swords. When he was president of that college, sort of a glorified community college up the road, Harvard, Larry Summers made a similar assertion at a conference there on Native American studies. Here's what he said. What actually comes out if you study it, and I think this is relatively established fact, is that for everyone who is killed or maimed in some attack by European descended Americans on the Native American population, for every conscious death that came in war, 10 were a consequence of the diseases that came to North America with European immigrants. The vast majority of the suffering that was visited on the Native American population as the Europeans came was not a plan or an attack, It was in many ways a coincidence, nobody's plan. The historians who first introduced disease into discussions of the conquest and colonization of the Americas did so for the best of reasons. They were attempting to overturn older historical explanations, which posited that the reason why small groups of Europeans conquered far larger native societies was because of European cultural or technological superiority. A closer attention to disease reworked such arguments by that suggesting that if Europeans enjoyed any superiority over Indians, it was purely immunological, the unearned outcome of the very different disease environment in Eurasia compared to the Americas. In a strange way, however, the success of this revisionist disease argument also opened up new avenues for deniability. Once bacteria and viruses had been cast as historical actors with their own agency, it could no longer be claimed quite so easily that native death and dispossession were solely the products of European actions. Nevertheless, it seems clear to me that the relationship between disease and genocide is ripe for a more nuanced reexamination. First of all, it's not at all obvious that disease as an explanatory model works equally well in all times and places. It's indeed true that in the initial years of European contact, disease had a devastating effect on native communities that had never before experienced Eurasian maladies. But even so-called virgin soil populations can recover their numbers and acquire immunity with time. Indeed, in later centuries, the disease differential between native and settler societies was much less pronounced and therefore is not particularly helpful in explaining European and Euro-American dominance. Furthermore, it's worth comparing how disease has been treated in the North American case versus other genocides. The most famous victim of the Holocaust, Anne Frank, did not die from a Nazi bullet or gas chamber, but rather expired in Bergen-Belsen from typhus, a tick or lice-borne bacteria. Yet I suspect no reputable scholar would argue that Anne Frank was not really a victim of genocide because she died of disease rather than being killed by a Nazi. Typhus is a classic disease of overcrowding, filth, and malnutrition. Clearly, Frank's mistreatment in Bergen-Belsen set the stage for her demise. In the same way, many native deaths should not be seen as purely as a function of disease, but instead need to be connected to the loss of food and other natural resources, the forced labor and other stresses that accompanied European conquest, for such factors can have a dramatic role in increasing a host population's vulnerability to infection. To return for one last moment to the California Gold Rush, the disease here that most affected native populations was not measles or mumps, to which California Indians had been exposed to for generations, but instead venereal diseases, which were spread by the sexual abuse of Indian women and either left many women sterile or damaged their offspring. And venereal disease is, of course, the disease that you can say that Europeans had a direct role in infecting native communities with. The final problem with intent is perhaps the most troubling of all. Focusing unduly on intent, as the UN Convention encourages us to do, risk directing our attention away from the victims of genocide and instead towards its perpetrators. If the key question, after all, that we are trying to answer is intent, the perpetrators, their actions, their decisions, their culture, inevitably becomes far more important to historians than the victims. As a result, in an odd way, the new genocide history has served to recapitulate the old Indian history. This old Indian history was a classic commanders and campaigns, boots and saddles literature, in which Indians appeared only as military obstacles to U.S. manifest destiny. Its heroes were men like General George Crook, who had achieved a deep understanding of Indian peoples, even if they only used this knowledge to defeat them, at which point natives disappeared forever from the pages of history. The new genocide history, of course, should be applauded for attempting to invert the moral valence of this older literature by demonstrating the genocidal violence that accompanied U.S. expansion. Yet even as it converts one-time heroes into genocidal villains, the new genocide history reinscribes non-natives as the central actors of history, once more pushing indigenous peoples to the margins of history, and once more calling up old tropes about the passive Indian who exists outside of time. Indians yet again become important not for themselves, not because their history has intrinsic value in and of itself, but instead for the mirror that they hold up to settler society. It's for this reason that, from my perspective, there's a somewhat uneasy relationship between scholars of genocide and practitioners of the so-called new Indian history. By reading documents against the grain and by using such novel methodologies as material culture, oral history, and oral tradition, new Indian historians have over the past quarter century endeavored to situate Native peoples as active co-participants in the making of American history. The new Indian history has also directed welcome attention to the staggering diversity of Native cultures, languages, and experiences, and shed new light on the ways that Native peoples have preserved and understood their history. Undergirding much of this work is a commitment to Native sovereignty, to understanding how it worked in the past and how decolonization might reinvigorate sovereignty in the future. The place of genocide in such an analysis is uncertain, a situation perhaps best captured by the controversy over the Smithsonian's National Museum of the American Indian. Some critics of the museum, such as Amy Lone Tree, have charged that the museum glosses over the what she calls the painful truths of our history and fails to hold the U.S. government accountable for genocidal acts against our ancestors. For his part, the museum's founding director, W. Richard West, who is also a Native person, maintained that he wanted the museum to focus on survival rather than its functioning as a Native American Holocaust museum, a twin, as it were, to the Jewish Holocaust Museum just across the National Mall in Washington, D.C. There are echoes here of the long-running debate in the Jewish community over what the place of the final solution should be in framing modern Jewish identity. But there are also important distinctions. For many practitioners of the new Indian history, the focus on Native annihilation at the heart of genocide studies merits a cautious response. Dwelling on past episodes of mass violence against Native communities risks reinforcing the narrative of decline and disappearance that has too long dominated white perceptions of Indian peoples, epitomized in the trope of the vanishing Indian. The suggestion that Indian communities have been, in the language of the UN's Genocide Convention, destroyed in whole or in part, can work at cross purposes to contemporary efforts to reclaim treaty rights, assert sovereignty, or attain tribal recognition. In the latter case, groups that want to be recognized by the BIA need to demonstrate features such as historical continuity across time as a, quote, distinct tribal community, and a consistent form of political influence or authority over its members. Discussions of genocide complicate such efforts by suggesting possible ruptures in the historical continuity of communities and their leadership. Even for federally recognized tribes, invoking the specter of the past mass destruction of community members can make it harder to assert claims in the court of public opinion, as it seems to suggest a destruction of culture, often the metric non-natives use to assess the credibility of Native claims, or to imply that the Native population has become smaller and therefore less deserving of access to resources, even those to which it has a right under federal treaties. And it's for this reason that I think it's so important to include Native voices whenever we talk about genocide in the Americas. I tried to do this in a small way with the excerpts that I read to you at the beginning of my talk. I think it's much more important in the panel that we'll be having later on today. All this being said, it's not my purpose to argue today that there's an unbridgeable chasm between the new Indian history and the new genocide history. And so I wanted to close by pointing to several fruitful avenues for new inquiry. The first would be to trace the linkages between the U.S.'s genocide against Native peoples and later German genocides in Africa and Europe. There were close connections between the Prussian Army and the U.S. Army in the mid-19th century. Prussian officers came to the U.S. during the Civil War to observe Union tactics on the battlefield. In turn, several U.S. officers, including Philip Sheridan, who fought Cheyenne, Kiowa, and Comanche and other Plains people in the late 1860s, went to Europe in 1871 to observe the Franco-Prussian War. Upon his return to the U.S., Sheridan was then responsez for campaigns against the Lakota, Nez Perce, Ute, and Apache. We also know that some of the German officers from the Franco-Prussian War were later involved in German extermination efforts against the Herero people in Namibia, Africa in the early 1900s, an atrocity that is considered by most scholars to represent the first genocide of the 20th century, and which may have laid the foundation for the later final solution during World War II. The general in charge of Namibia, Lothar von Trotha, in fact explicitly referenced the American West to justify his actions. In his words, "The natives must give way, look at America, either via the bullet or the mission with alcohol." During World War II, one can find similar statements suggesting that the Germans viewed their venture into Eastern Europe as having strong parallels to U.S. expansion into the Western United States. In 1941, for example, Hitler stated, "There is only one task, to set about the Germanization of land by bringing in Germans and to regard the indigenous inhabitants as Indians." This attempt to portray U.S. settler colonialism in the American West as entangled on some level with German settler colonialism in Eastern Europe is further reinforced by shifts in the historiography on the final solution. The older literature casts the Holocaust as a poisoned fruit of modernity, the creation of some sort of vast bureaucracy of modern society that diminished a sense of personal responsibility, the involvement of new technologies like railroads and chemicals. But recently, scholars have revised this understanding, that pointing out that most of the mass killing of Jews and others took place in the East, where it was done through such simple measures as starvation and mass shooting, techniques not all that different from the ones that U.S. settlers used in North America. The second point of congruence would hinge on the realization that to the extent that genocide against Native Americans was incomplete, this was not a result of lack of intent, but of Native agency. The ability of American Indians to resist extermination campaigns against them, either militarily or through flight. The Holocaust historian Tim Snyder in Black Earth has argued that what rendered Jews especially vulnerable during the final solution were those moments when they were rendered stateless without a larger community to protect them. In contrast, Native Americans were members of communities that were able to take effective collective action in the face of efforts to destroy them. We might thus properly approach the history of genocide against Native Americans by expanding the concept that the Native scholar Phil DeLoria advanced several years ago. Writing contemporary Indian history, Phil wrote, requires a creative weaving together of contradictions. In the case of Native American genocide, this means recognizing the reality of the massive violence against North America's indigenous peoples, at the same time as acknowledging the Native agency that enabled some forms of survival to take place, the creation of what the Anishinaabe scholar Gerald Visner has dubbed survivance, which he calls an active sense of presence, the continuance of Native stories, not a mere reaction or a survivable name. Finally, we might begin to think about stories of violence that transcend the often rather simplistic yes-no binary that the question of genocide all too often imposes in our studies of the past. These debates about, yes, genocide took place, no, it didn't take place, which because the UN Convention focuses solely on intent, it does not necessarily invite us to investigate the deeper causes of violence. What were the cultural or material conditions that caused settlers to embrace genocide at some moments and not at others? Elsewhere, I've argued we could properly unpack at greater length the concept of extermination, which is how 19th century Euro-Americans discussed violence against indigenous peoples, and which is shot through with assumptions about nature and its influence on human events. 19th century settlers, of course, could not have used the term genocide because it wasn't coined until after World War II. We might talk about variations in Native experiences of violence. Native communities that experience genocide and then inflict horrible acts on other Native communities. Native communities that serve as auxiliaries in genocidal settler campaigns, the decisions that Native communities make as how to remember or not their experiences of genocide. There's an ongoing debate outside the Americas about the role of the state in genocide. Does genocide take place where the state is weak, or do we need a strong state to create the conditions for genocide? This is something that American historians could probably contribute to, but currently do little to engage. Only once we begin to grapple with such questions and the vast scale of the violence that these questions in turn summon into being, will we be able to move beyond a wondering horror to a more complete assessment of the North American past. Thank you very much. So it's my understanding we have about 15 minutes for questions. Is that correct, Robin? Just need some brave soul to get us started. Yes, sir, way in the back. Or ma'am, I'm sorry, I can't see from up here with all these lights. The smallpox blankets. So the smallpox blankets, most of the story comes out from Lord Geoffrey Amherst, for whom Amherst is named, during Pontiac's Rebellion. He writes to one of his commanders and says, we should think about distributing smallpox blankets to the Indians. It's not clear that this ever happened. So, again, I'm not trying to diminish the reality of what did happen, but it's actually something that exists in the realm of popular folklore much more than it actually exists in the reality of what happened. Certainly in this case, if you're thinking about intent, Lord Geoffrey Amherst had every intent to actually do this kind of primitive kind of germ warfare. Earlier on, there was a long time that Europeans didn't necessarily know how disease worked, so that there's sometimes times of conscious use of disease, but there's sometimes where they frankly didn't know how it was working. This is why when people are using disease, I think it's a very complicated issue, but as I was trying to suggest, the larger issue that I think has been ignored in this is that people respond to diseases. It has a lot to do with your general state of health, and if you're being colonized, if you're doing forced labor, if you're being, you know, your food is being taken away from you, you're much more likely to die off. And if you look at other cases where people have been exposed to unusual diseases like the Black Death in Europe, populations are able to rebuild themselves so that had colonization not taken place, native populations would have been able to rebuild themselves regardless of the presence of new diseases. So my large argument is that we need to be thinking more about actual actions that Europeans did rather than disease itself as a possible explanation. It's a possibility. I guess what I would say from looking at the historical record, it wasn't as common as one thinks that it existed possibly in a very few number of documented cases, but was not as widely done as the popular folklore is. Yeah.
Check, check.
My good listening is on or not, but you had spoken about structures rather than intent. And I had a hard time connecting that, because I would think that one starts off with thinking of an intent and then builds the structure to make the intent happen. So I just want to put that out there, because that's how I view it. You know, like if I'm intending to have lamb for dinner,
right,
I'm going to go get the lamb to make sure I have it. So this structure versus intent, I think, should be reversed. It's people coming here with a specific intent and then building the structure to take action on the intent. I'd like to have your opinion on that.
Well, I mean, I absolutely agree in terms of the deeper analysis. You're entirely correct. What I'm trying to say, because I think that this is the problem with intent, which again is baked into the definition of genocide from the UN Convention, is that it allows this possibility for denial, because it's one thing as a legal definition when you can put people on the stand, right, and cross-examine them. I think you can get closer to issues of intent. When we as a historians are in essence trying to do this retroactively, going by very dispersed historical documents to try to discern intent, sometimes it's difficult to document intent. And this has allowed people who want to deny the reality of genocide to say, well, you don't have something that clearly says the intent of this person to do this thing, therefore there's no genocide. And so what I'm trying to say is, if you can find the intent, that's great. And I would agree exactly with the formulation that you're creating. But if the structure is there, we don't need to get caught up in this discussion about intent as much, and we can look at the structure and the reality that structure suggests of genocide. And so that's what I'm trying to do. Not to say that, because my fear has been that we often then get sucked into these almost improvable issues about intent, which have everything to do with about holes in the historical record. And it then allows people not to really address and face up to the reality of genocide, which I think can be structurally determined. Does that make sense as an answer? Yeah.
So I had a question. Oh. Sorry, right here.
Oh, yes.
Hi. So I was kind of interested in how you feel that Sand Creek, the massacre at Sand Creek and the attack on Black Kettle's winter camp, played into this campaign against natives and this idea of extermination, because it seemed to me that those two massacres were deliberately trying to get rid of an entire population.
Yeah, I mean, so Sand Creek, for people who don't know what this happens, I think it's 1863 outside of Denver. It's an attack led by Chivington on a camp of Arapaho and Cheyenne, and they kill something on the order of 200 or more people who believe that they're at peace, right? And then they're basically attacked by the Colorado militia. You know, clearly this if the quote is to destroy in whole or in part a community, this is clearly something that meets the definition of genocide. And Chivington, to answer the earlier question about intent, I think he's someone where you actually have intent. Like you clearly have a model of him talking about the need to kill all of the members of that camp. So, you know, that's one of those many episodes that quite clearly fits into the definitions that we're talking about here. Does that more or less answer the question? I guess I was trying to sort of get at some of the deeper issues rather than just list one. I could be here all day just listing all these various massacres that meet these criteria. Yes, sir.
I guess, yeah, I'm on. As we go through life, where we take actions on many things, and of course the motivation for those actions can certainly vary. A number of years ago, I read a book by Vine Deloria. I think I heard you mention him a while ago. And the title of that book was Their Love of Possession is a Disease with Them. Would you care to give us your opinion about that subject? The person in the rear spoke about intent. We're motivated to take actions as a result of several kinds of stimuli. But what about that title of that book? What's your opinion about that book as it relates to what happened here many, many years ago? And of course, we are still seeing an occasion when that's happening today.
I'm sorry, I missed, he wrote so many books, I missed the title that you...
The title of the book by Vine Deloria is Their Love of Possession is a Disease with Them.
Is a disease with them. The person I was quoting was actually Phil Deloria, who's Vine's son. I think clearly, I haven't read all of Vine's books because he's written quite so many, but I think what that book, if I recollect it correctly, is getting at is this question about settler colonialism, which is to say that the love of possession of land, right? And that and this gets back to the question of intent as well, that the United States is a classic example of a settler colonial society where non-natives, what they want is land, and any way that they need to get rid of the native community to claim that land is what they're willing to do, right? Be it through forced removal or through killing the inhabitants. So, he's more metaphorical than I am in terms of whether one wants to call that a disease or what one wants to call it, but it's clearly the ruling ideology is one of, it almost goes all the way back to Locke in terms of the classic idea that land, in the European mind, land belongs to the person who works it, and so that Europeans have a more legitimate claim to this land than non-native people. And so this notion of property may on the face of it sound very benign, but it leads you to do all sorts of really terrible things. I mean, I think this makes me think a lot about the ways in which notions of utopia and dystopia are tied together, which is to say that there's a kind of utopian vision of the United States as land for all and a sort of a free land that can allow people from Europe who didn't have access to land have land. But where does that land come from, of course? It comes from dispossessing and attempting to destroy native communities. And so that's the disease, as it were.
One last thing, Karl. You were talking about building bridges so that the historians and the indigenous communities can be on a more honorable and honest path to talking to each other and understanding each other. And so my question to you is, when the sickness of ownership and possession came built on a fear from those that came to colonize us, how does the indigenous person go about helping them to heal their own sickness? Because what's going to happen is people will get better for a day, a week, or whatever, and then they'll go back to their own communities where they're seeing people that just look like them and worship like them. And if it wasn't for affirmative action, most of these corporations wouldn't be hiring anybody of color. So how do we build those bridges to where we can sit in honor, but in honesty, so that our communities can be healed once and for all?
Well, if I knew the exact answer to that question, of course, that's the question at the heart of what we're trying to do, right? I can only answer, for me as a historian, one of the first steps is we have to get the true record out there. And I think that's something that as I tried to talk in my talk, I'm not particularly proud, by and large, of how the historical profession has dealt with this issue, right? it's still something that's fairly new and controversial, even within the academy, talking about Native genocide, let alone out in the wider culture. But I think that one of the first steps is acknowledgement. Now, acknowledgement may not mean healing per se, but I don't think before we can even heal, we have to acknowledge. And I don't think we've gotten to the point that we've acknowledged, right? And then I think the question for us is, once you have this knowledge, what do you do with that knowledge? And I do think that the issue of reparations is a valid one. I think that we tend to gloss reparations as simply writing a check to someone, but the deeper meaning of the word, which your question brings up really nicely, is that the issue of reparations, the root word for reparations is repair, the effort to try to repair. And it might be a difficult process, it might be an incomplete process, but I feel like there should at least be a willingness to try to, if once you've acknowledged the damage that's been done, to try to think about what can you do to repair that damage so that one can move forward in a more just relationship.
In response to that, I just want to say thank you, because it does start with people of your ethnicity and your nationality to speak out about it, because the indigenous people are less likely to be listened to unless it comes from the historians that wrote the misconception.
Yeah, no,
Thank you very much.
I'm very aware of that. It's not as though Native communities know genocide took place, right? It's not, they don't need to be taught this, but the larger non-Native community, they're the ones that really need to begin this process of acknowledgement.
Yeah, my question goes with her. So you're saying, I mean, you don't believe that from your personal view, from a start would be where, let's say Thanksgiving, celebrating Thanksgiving. I mean, a lot of people don't understand what that means to Native American people. And I feel like if we stop celebrating Thanksgiving and really understand it, we'll have a better view of how we can heal the communities and the indigenous people. If you do, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying, but.
Yeah, no, I wrote a piece about this because one of the first Thanksgivings was given after King Philip's War, and it was given for, Thanksgiving by the settlers for victory over the Indians, right? Yep. And so it has a very, you can trace it back to a very difficult, violent history. It's when I was at Brown, I used to teach at Brown. When I was at Brown, we were involved with some of the students there in trying to change the name of Thanksgiving break and Columbus Day, which was difficult to do in largely Italian-American Providence. But these are, what your question gets to, and the more important issue is this issue of memorialization, right? Which is the question of how do we remember these things? And I think the real danger about Thanksgiving is that you tend to remember a very sanitized, happy history, right? That's the peril of Thanksgiving. And to the extent that kind of memorialization takes place, it really inhibits us from having this fuller reckoning, which then can begin to deal with the acknowledgement and everything else that needs to take place.
Another question. So you say that America needs to realize and understand of how the indigenous people were treated back then. Do you think the same intentions is put forth now from back then with the American, the white man and the Native Americans? Do you think, because from what I see and what I know is a lot has not been done with tribes and reservations. There's still tribes on small acres of reservations and you know what I'm saying? So,
yeah, I mean, I had two thoughts for you. I mean, the first is I always think about property. You know, if you ever tried to do historical research, one of the best documented things in records is property, and because that's so important to American society. And if you take that chain of property backwards, it ultimately always goes to some native dispossession, right? And so that native dispossession is still ongoing. And one other little story I might tell you, I was doing a presentation a couple years ago with, which I think gets at the point you're getting at too, I was doing a presentation with some elders from the San Carlos Apache Reservation, because one of my books deals with the San Carlos Apache, and I spent a lot of time on the reservation there. And we were doing a presentation in Tucson, and this was right after, I guess about 2009, so when the Depression had happened. And the elder was saying something I thought was really profound, that you know the so-called Great Recession had taken place, and unemployment rate was 10% in the United States, and people were just freaking out at how awful the unemployment rate was and how sort of cataclysmic and catastrophic this is. And the elder was saying, well, on San Carlos, the unemployment rate is 70%. It's always been 70%, and American society is completely willing, you know, it's a crisis when it's 10% among non-natives unemployment. But when 70% is business as usual among native communities, that's not considered a crisis or a problem or anything. It's just tolerated, right? Is that one more issue? Do we need to go? Okay, I guess I need to keep on schedule, and this just sort of suggests how many important questions come out of this. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you so much. It's very important to get this kind of larger context, and there's much more, obviously, to know, and there's some references that Dr. Jacoby gave us, and I'm sure he'll be glad to talk to people individually. We're going to take a very short break. We have lots of coffee and pastry out there. Come back in about 10 minutes, and we'll get set up. We're going to have a wonderful panel here, so don't leave.